So as you may know, this last couple of years, I've just sort of put out any topics that people would be interested in. And I've got a lot of requests for this topic tonight, which is how do you navigate kind of the challenges of a breakup and in relationships and just the skillful means of relationships. Anyone here ever gone through a breakup at some point in your life? Somewhat relevant. It's been said that we need five things in relationship. And we need a person who makes us laugh. We need a person who is intellectually stimulating. We need a person who is sensually stimulating. And we need a person who's masterful in creating wealth and security. And the fifth, we need some way for those four people never to meet. So I'd like to talk a little bit of how, particularly when you look at life in terms of a journey, as a spiritual journey, it's a solo journey. You're really on your own, ultimately. And how life is fueled by desire. Desire is what drives us. You know, and I'll talk a little bit about what's called tanha in Pali, which is described as thirst, this deep thirst we have for life and for more. And to talk a little bit about how desire leads to attraction and how attraction leads to relationship and how to manage a relationship when it's challenging and how to manage a relationship when it's over. When you think of life as the hero's journey, something calls you in life and you set off to seek whatever that is. And we can think of the Buddha's life as a great allegory for that. You know, this calling to be awake and free, and then all the trials and challenges that occur in that. That's our life. That's the life that we have lived. And when you think about your own inspiration in life, the mistakes that you've made, the desires you've tracked, and realize that's not really what you want, refreshing what you really, really want, pursuing that, feeling lost. This is the journey. It's messy. It's complicated. You know, we're born alone. We die alone. And we're born into a body that is biologically designed to propagate the species. You know, we are just biologically designed to keep this race moving forward. And that life force has a huge amount of strength. If you've ever had the privilege of watching someone transition from life, it's a fascinating thing because you see how life is fighting for itself to the very last breath. It's a fascinating thing to see. That desire to live is so strong. And desire leads to attraction. We're attracted to what we feel is going to make us whole. And that's the nature of this whole journey. And the question then is, what do we really want? I could never figure out, looking at my parents, how two such opposite people would ever get together. How did they end up with each other? And I know it was kind of after World War II, you know, they were both involved in the war, and there was a sense of let's hurry up and start making babies and get on with life. But I wonder sometimes about that. Have you ever noticed that? With couples that you've known in your life, like, how in the world did those two people find a way to connect? Have you ever thought about your partner, if you have one, and thought, how in the world did we connect? It's really interesting to look at the nature of desire. This essential quality of tanha, this essential thirst that we have for life, is we're looking for something that will complete us, whatever that may be. I think it was Hegel who said, everything we do is designed to soothe our anxiety. You know, we're looking for something that's going to make it okay. And when you're attracted to someone or something, there's some sense that this is going to complete you. This is going to be it. And when it comes to relationships, quite often there's that sense of there's something in this other person that feels like it completes a circle. It was Harville Hendricks who created imago theory, and he wrote a really famous book that made him famous called Getting the Love You Want. And then he followed that up with a book called Keeping the Love You Have. And I keep waiting for his third book, which I imagine will be Dumping the Schmuck You've Got. But I haven't seen that one yet. But he has a great phrase. He says that romantic love is the anesthesia that brings two incompatible people together for the purpose of healing. And part of his work is designed, it's called the imago. And that is you're drawn to, in relationship, to this perception of completing what is incomplete with your primary caretakers. And that's part of the essential drive. And so what happens is when there's that sense of romantic love, your barriers are down, the other person's barriers are down, and there's a sense of completion. So if my ego is not in the way and your ego is not in the way, oh my God, there's this amazing sense of completion that we have. And that feels amazing. And that's the nature of attraction, that sense of completion. And then, of course, when we're sort of in that state of falling in love, you know, one person will say, oh, she's so expressive. I love how she doesn't hold back. She just says whatever she's feeling. And she'll say, he's so contained and so reserved. He has such a sense of inner presence. And it's just amazing. And eventually that becomes, my God, she won't stop talking about her feelings. Whenever I try to be honest, she hijacks what I'm feeling and takes it over. And she'll say, like, he never says what's going on. He's driving me insane. Have you ever wondered that in your relationships? That there's a sort of this transcendent sense of magic, and then what you're attracted to becomes the complaint. And this sense of, again, attraction and desire, that taste of completion, and then sensing how that shifts can be really challenging. And then the question becomes, well, then how do you navigate this relational field? And one approach presented by many different religious traditions all over the planet basically says, don't go there. You know, as I've shared before, no relationship problems. You know, the monastic traditions, you know, Catholic priests, nuns, subjugate your desires. Don't engage into the world of illusion, and you'll get through this life clean. When I had a celibacy vow for 6.5 years, we used to always tell this story of St. Tulsidas. The story is that he was a young boy who grew up in his village in India, and he fell madly in love with this girl in another village, and he just couldn't be apart from her. And so one night he had to see her, so he put on his dress whites and he took off, and he had to cross a river and go through a swamp and then crawled up the tree outside her window and called out to her. And she looked out, and there's this mud-spattered, wild-eyed guy hanging in a tree, you know. And she says, if you love God as much as you love me, you'd be enlightened by now. And he goes, you're right. And he goes off and drops relationship and becomes enlightened. So we told ourselves that story to feel better. When I was in the ashram, I called myself a junior varsity monk. We had the lifetime monks, the ones who took lifetime vows, and for many years I was considering lifetime vows, and I had this moment of profound insight when we had some big community gathering, and all the monks were over here, and all the senior married couples were over here. And all the monks look kind of gray and sort of dried up. And all the relationship people look really juicy. And I thought, let's see. Column A, column B. Maybe there's something here in column B. And so inevitably for most of us, we're drawn to explore awakening through relationship. That's where we're called to this field. And of course, like anything, as the Buddha taught, like most people are looking for happiness in exactly the wrong way. You know, we believe we're going to find it through things. We're going to believe we're going to find it through the senses, when really what we're cultivating is happiness that is independent of externals. In that same way, quite often we move into relationship thinking it's going to make us happy. And of course, that becomes a really important part in exploring conscious relationship. And from time to time, I work with couples and their challenges. And I say very clearly, I'm not a couples therapist, but I do know some killer techniques in communication that can be really helpful. And there was one particular couple, and they were in a real battle, a real struggle. Basically, what it came down to was that he was wanting more connection. He was wanting to do things. He was wanting to do things more together. And she was wanting more freedom. She wanted to be more self-expressed and live more of her life. And inevitably, what would happen in their relationship is that he would get really frustrated, and then he would just blow up and explode, and then she would kind of withdraw and sort of judge him, and it just kept going through that cycle over and over and over again. And what's really wonderful about this model of imago is that we begin to recognize that all of our conditioning, like our essential wounds, show up in our relationships. And so as we kind of explored a little bit of their background, for him, his parents were very distant. They were really withholding affection, attention, and love. If he got any praise, it was very faint. And he really had a very deep desire to feel like he belonged and he was cared for and that he was part of something. And for her, she had a very controlling mother who tried to micromanage her and hovered all the time, which built up a huge amount of resentment for her. And as soon as she could, she kind of got away from the whole family system. And here they were. And they had a very deep sense of attention and affection and love between them in their transcendent moments where their wounds kind of matched. And so often what we need to do in relationship is to learn to really sense the wound of the other. And when we can really, really see and we can role reverse, there can be a flow of empathy and understanding. So for her to really understand this very, very deep wound and this very deep need that he had to feel connected and belonging softened her a little bit. And for him to understand that having that sense of autonomy and freedom was really, really important to her. It didn't solve all their problems, of course, but that understanding allowed them to move forward in a really conscious way and to slow things down a little bit. And it becomes a very interesting reflection to see and to reflect on how your woundedness shows up in relationships. Are you someone who moves toward connection, who has a certain quality of wanting connection and affirmation? Are you someone who tends to withdraw and pull back? Understanding self becomes so helpful when it comes to understanding relationship. When you can begin to sense anyone you're in relationship with as sort of that wounded teenager, you picture them as a teenager, that's oftentimes provides a really helpful insight. After when I lived in our spiritual community, we had a mandatory time of celibacy. And then if you were interested in exploring relationship, you kind of went into this relationship program where basically they just beat the tar out of you. You know, you really think you're going to be happy in a relationship and so forth. And really what it came down to, and I really came to understand this, like in evaluating relationship, is like, is this someone you can actually work your stuff with? Because if you want to be awake and you want to be free, everything in your life that isn't awake and free is going to come present, like it or not. And it's when you embrace that, it's this magical process of just unpeeling the onion as you really sense your conditioning and meet it with wisdom and meet it with compassion. You become less bound and more free. But just doing that for yourself is hard enough. You bring another person into the mix with their undigested, unfelt, unseen forces. It gets complicated. And so seeing the wound of the other is incredibly helpful. The art of role reversal, you know, to really, what is this person feeling, is tremendously helpful. I've always loved this phrase, and again, it'll show up in any intimate relationship you're in. What you can't communicate controls you. If there's something you can't communicate, you are bound by that. And there are wonderful, skillful means for finding ways to articulate what's below the line of awareness so you can make it more present. There's a process that Tara and I have done for a couple of years now that has been immensely helpful in our relationship. Because it's so easy to let things slip, you know, to not name something and realize how that just sort of festers inside. So we do a little process, and it sort of evolved over time. And it was very unconscious at first. You know, I would just assume everything was fine. And then Tara would say something like, "We never talk," which of course would elicit a response something like, "We just talked yesterday. What do you mean? What do you mean we never talk?" And we would eventually process something. And finally, the frustration reached a point where I said, "Look, let's schedule it. Let's just schedule a time to talk so this stuff doesn't build up." So twice a week, we have our check-in where we sit for 20 minutes. And then we have three questions. And the first question is, what are you grateful for? And we just take a minute or two just to sort of name what we appreciate in life, which oftentimes will include the other. And that question is always so powerful. You know, you can't be grateful and angry at the same time. You know, you can't be appreciative and feel rage at the same time. So that opens up the field a little bit. Then the second question is, what are your current challenges? And inevitably, that question is so powerful because when I'm listening to her share what her current challenges are, oftentimes she's naming things I wasn't even aware of. And I realize, oh my gosh, I had no idea you were working that relationship issue or you had that thing to plan for. And it's helpful for me to kind of name what's present as well. Then the third question is, what's between us and feeling clear? Or what's between us and feeling love? And then we can begin to name the how we're withholding or how maybe, I'm really, really been tied up with this project. I'm aware that maybe I haven't been as attentive as I could be, et cetera, et cetera. It helps to kind of clear the field. That's been such a wonderful investment. It's really, really been helpful. Probably one of the most helpful things that we've done, and to really lock them into the calendar. Because there are quite a few times when it's on the calendar and there's nothing in me that wants to do it. But I know it'll always be worth it. And so far, we've never done it. And I've thought later, we shouldn't have done that. It's always beneficial. But when you're in a relationship and you're working it, there are certain things to be aware of, to really take responsibility for what you're feeling, to really explore how you're not communicating. What am I not sharing? To find ways to kind of identify what your experience is. And a very, very helpful one, I know this is kind of across the board, is to really name your exits. Is to really make it known how you exit from the relationship. How you pull away from connectedness, which can be myriad ways. And that's really tough, just to really say, here's how I escape. Here are the red flags that I'm pulling away. I think relationships are really hard work, to keep them awake and alive. But I truly believe that they're the fast lane if you really want to wake up. When I sat there looking at the renunciates versus the married couples, and I remember thinking, boy, if those renunciates really wanted to wake up, they should get in relationships. So it's important to learn the toolbox for being present in relationship. And I think ultimately there is a recognition as well of taking responsibility in relationship, but then also recognizing when a relationship is no longer working. And how do you know that point? I'd like to say a little bit about that. Someone said, I married Mr. Wright. I just didn't know his first name was Always. So another one, this couple, she's 98 and he's 102. They're in the lawyer's office filing for divorce. And the lawyer says, why now? And she says, well, we wanted to wait until the children were dead. So I think in any relationship, at any time, really the conversation, whether you're entering into a relationship or you're evaluating where you are in a relationship, or you're sensing, is this the end? Or is there a way we can refresh this relationship? I really think it comes down to a conversation something like this. Let me tell you what lights me up. Let me tell you how I would like to live the rest of the days of my life, knowing that there's no guarantee of how many I have. And then I want to hear from you. What lights you up? how do you want to live the rest of your days, knowing the length of your days are not guaranteed? And then let's have a conversation of how we can support each other in that. There's a, I heard this one story, and I've never forgotten this. It's a story that Ram Dass tells. And he was spent many years in a relationship with his teacher named Emmanuel. It was, there's a whole story about that, but a, kind of a wise sort of channeled being. And someone asked Emmanuel and said, how do you know when a relationship is over? After you worked on it and you prayed about it and you've journaled about it and you've talked it through, how do you know when it's over? And Emmanuel's response blew me away. Emmanuel said, quite frankly, my dear, when you've had enough. And that happened for me in a relationship, where I just realized, after turning every stone over that I could turn and wanting to be honest and evaluating and looking, am I running away? Is there more I could do, et cetera, et cetera? I reached a point where I'd had enough. I was done. And I find that's a really edgy thing. Because there's an element where we can run away from an opportunity for growth. And then there can be a very life-affirming sense of, this is complete. And it's so important to really be brutally honest. Have I really turned over every stone? Have I been really truthful in my assessment of myself and what I most want? So a very specific question that someone had on this topic was, what do you do when you're dumped? And it's a really interesting question. And again, I imagine we won't do a hand raise, but I would imagine some of us have been the dumper and some of us have been the dumpy at different times. But when a relationship ends, and sometimes it can end brutally, it can feel like a death. It's one thing to be in your teens and have a relationship and realize it's not right. But when they're children, when there's been a really deep betrayal, when there's been a really long, long relationship that comes to an end, when there's been really destructive behavior that's been tolerated for a long period of time, it's incredibly painful. And one way to think of it is, the stages of death that we go through. First, there is a sense of denial, and we can live in that for a really, really long time, where we continually try to engage in something that we know really isn't that life-affirming. And there can sometimes be those insights when you realize this is over. The next stage is bargaining. Well, maybe if I do this, maybe if we do that. And then quite often there's anger. There's the anger, the outrage, the deep hurt, the deep disappointment. And quite often then that's followed by resignation, which is the depression, the sense that of really deep loss. That's quite often the stage of I'll never have a life again. And then the accommodating. And it's kind of, again, like grief. When you lose someone, grief comes in rogue waves. You know, everything is fine. And then here comes a grief wave. And then the practice is to stay with that wave. I was listening to someone kind of talking about someone who was in the armed services, who a SEAL team, who lost very, very dear brothers. And he really talked about how there's almost like a protocol for loss. You know, first it's absolute intensity, just the absolute burning sense of complete disorientation and hurt. And then there are waves. And then there's space between the waves. And then there's guilt between the waves that you're not more upset about it. And then there's lessening over time. But what happens is when you go through the trauma of losing an intimate relationship, and again, there's so much we're learning about the brain, is how your brain will prioritize your ex-partner in the same way it'll prioritize paying attention to physical pain. So in doing functional MRIs, when people would look at a photo of a former lover or former relationship, the brain, it would show up in the brain as if it was the same thing as if they were getting a probe of like a painful probe in the skin. And it's very similar, going through the loss of intimate relationship is very similar to getting over an addiction. Because there is this trigger that we have of kind of romanticizing what we lost. And that actually triggers kind of endorphins in the brain. And that's why many, many people, when they're dumped or when a relationship ends, that they are desperately trying to get a response. They're hoping to get back. And they oftentimes will go into cyclical patterns of anger and depression and obsessive thinking. Anyone relate? So there's a term in yoga called samskaras. And they're also, the translation is a groove or a rut. So when there is a deep loss like this in relationship, and you're playing it over again and again, it's literally creating grooves. There are neurological pathways that get reinforced. When we go through the story of loss, we romanticize about what we lost. That sets the longing and the tanha, and that's why for many, many people, they can be in pain for a very, very long period of time. And then the question becomes, how can you mindfully begin to break the pattern? Because essentially you're simply looking at how can you break the pattern. So there are a few things you can do. One of them is to try to turn your attention elsewhere. You know, to not look at the pictures and the gifts and the sentimental reminders, and not to go to the places where you hung out together, because that will just kick in the dopamine-related craving in the brain. So it's why it's really, really helpful to remove the photos, remove the old stimulation, so you're not re-stimulating yourself. And then next is to look at how you can break the cycle of obsessive thinking. And that's where taking on new projects, you know, cleaning out your closet, you know, get a good friend that you can call, say, okay, well, I'm back on the wagon again. I'm just calling you to help me break the pattern. And then one of the most helpful things you can do is to change your energy. To literally change your energy. That's to run, to exercise, to change your state, change your physical state, and that can help you to change your mind. So it's a combination. It's just like we can't rush through grief. You know, grief comes in rogue waves. And part of the challenge is when you feel that wave of grief to stay on the wave until you can't find it. That's part of the healing of grief. In that same way, when it comes to loss in relationship, there's something about acknowledging the hurt, acknowledging the loss, but at the same time not indulging in the loss. In mindfulness practice, one of the most powerful phrases is that whatever arises, neither indulge nor deny. Don't pretend it isn't there, but you don't have to entertain it either. And then there's the question again, after, post-relationship. Because inevitably, when there's loss, tanha, desire, emerges again. Again, something in you is looking to feel more whole. And that becomes an opportunity to be more awake around what it is you really, really want, to really revisit that. And quite often there's a very deep burn, you know, I'll never go back again, I'll never trust myself again. And quite often there's wisdom in that. Yeah, don't trust yourself. You know, take some time and ask yourself what most enlivens you. Back to that question of what lights you up? How do you want to live the rest of your days, knowing your days aren't guaranteed? And to really reflect deeply on that, because that sets the desire radar so that you may not be attracted to an imago from the past, that you might be more conscious about who you partner with. There's a wonderful teaching I'd heard of, particularly when if you're not in a relationship and you're wanting to be, or you're ending a relationship and wondering what next, we have such a negativity bias where we tend to look back at our past relationships and focus on what didn't work. And what this teacher offered was look back over your past relationships and pick out the elements you really liked. You know, I really loved this person's sense of humor. This person really made me laugh. You know, I loved traveling with this person. Intimacy with this person was great. And the more you reflect on those positive traits, you're actually generating kind of a composite of what really enlivens you in life. I'm eternally grateful for someone's many, many years back. It was a wonderful relationship, but it came to an end and I ended it. And she said something to me at the end, which was enormously helpful. She said, you might want to see a therapist or something about relationships, because when it comes to this department, you're pretty screwed up. And I thought, you know, you may have something there. And so I did. And I really took time to really look at my avoidant tendencies. And that becomes part of what it means to live a more mindful life. What's between you and feeling fully alive? What's between you and feeling free? To look at what holds you back so that you can more clearly sense what really calls you forward. I think inevitably what it comes down to, and again, it's back to this essential drive of tanha, of desire, is really getting clear on what you truly desire in life. What do you really, really want? And what is most important in your life? And when you are guided by that, whether your life is solo or whether your life is partnered, having your life guided by that star is truly the most important thing. Why don't we take a few minutes to do a short meditation? You might take a moment or two to slow down your breath. And you might take a few moments to reflect on this question. What most lights you up in your life? How would you like to live the days that you have left, knowing there's no guarantee of how many you have? What do you really, really want in this fragile, precious life? And whether you are partnered in this life, whether you are happy in your partnership or not, or whether you are single right now, just take a few moments to reflect on how blessed you have been in this life. And we'll close. You might close by offering yourself a blessing. Imagine your life filled with a deepening sense of ease and well-being. And guided by wisdom, and guided by your heart. And imagine that you might offer that blessing out in all directions, to your left and right, above, below. May all beings feel an ease of well-being. May all be more deeply guided by wisdom and by their heart. When you're ready now, you can deepen your breath. And as you're ready, you can open your eyes. Thank you for your kind listening. Enjoy your week. I'll see you next week.